Hi everyone, my name is TARDIS Girl and welcome to my channel. Sorry for the obnoxiously clickbaity title, but gotta get butts in seats somehow. If you've been watching my episode reviews of His Dark Materials Season 2, then you'll know I haven't been too complimentary of the newest series. In fact, I've been pretty negative and critical. Well, when I think about all my grievances for His Dark Materials Season 2, my problems aren't with the acting, the CGI, the cinematography, the designs, because that kind of quality has been carried over from Season 1. All my problems are with the writing and the storytelling. So I thought the best thing to do would be to make this video expressing why I was so let down by the writing in His Dark Materials Season 2. I'm going to analyse some key scenes, some of which I like, some of which I absolutely hate, compare the writing to Season 1, and really dig deep into how the show suffers from bad storytelling. This video is going to be in three categories. In the first one, I'm going to be comparing and contrasting how Season 1 and Season 2 reveal information. In Part 2, I'm going to be discussing how character moments are structured and/or butchered by bad dialogue. And in Part 3, I'm going to be going over the way that Season 2 added or left out plot points from the books. A quick word of warning, a lot of these subjects are the ones I've talked about in superficial detail in my episode reviews. But like I said, I really wanted to go into detail and express in my own words how I really feel like this series was let down by its script. Although, I'm probably just going to end up whining about plot holes and spoilers for the whole video. Oh, and gratuitous spoilers for the book, for the show, for everything. So, let's get into it. Here's my video on how the writing in His Dark Materials means that Season 2 just wasn't as good as Season 1. I'll say it right now, the writing in Season 1 wasn't perfect. There were some moments of really obvious exposition, and sometimes the dialogue felt a little manufactured and just didn't sound natural. However, one of the advantages of Season 1 is that it could be really subtle when it wanted to be, only giving the audience a limited amount of information and letting us figure out the rest for ourselves. Compare this to Season 2, where they hit you over the head with explanations. Let's take a look at some examples of Season 1 and Season 2. I'm going to begin with the final scene from Season 1, Episode 3, where Mrs. Coulter retrieves the spyfly.
Spyfly. Are you out of your mind?
We've found her.
Mrs. Coulter takes the spyfly out of the air, but all she says is, "We found her," letting the audience know that she's going to set off on her search for Lyra. As we've already had Far Decorum say in a previous scene that the escaped spyfly will warn Mrs. Coulter that it has seen Lyra, so they'll need to flee north immediately to get a head start on her. This is all the information that we need.
What worries me is the one that's got away.
Right now it'll be on its way to Mrs. Coulter to tell her it has seen you. We go north. Now.
However, if this scene had been in Season 2, Mrs. Coulter would have said something like, "The spyfly is telling me that Lyra is with the Egyptians and they're going to go north, so I'm going to go north too to search for her." Stating information that we've already been given, but making sure that we know that she knows, even though it's blindingly obvious in the first place. This hypothetical example illustrates one of my biggest problems with Season 2, that the writers clearly didn't have enough material to flesh out 7 episodes, so they resorted to repeating the same information over and over again, but with different characters, such as this moment in the final episode, where Rutaskadi hears from the Cliffghasts that Lord Asriel needs Esahetra to win the war, but he doesn't have it. She then goes back and relays the same information to Serafina Pekkala, reiterating everything we've heard multiple times throughout this season.
"I came across some Cliffghasts. They spoke of the Esahetra, something that will be the difference between winning and losing."
Another big problem with this scene is that Season 2 doesn't know how to do reveals properly. Instead, information that is enormously relevant to the plot is spoken about before it's meant to come up in the actual story. I've stated before, the series doesn't have to stay 100% accurate to the books, and while these changes don't exactly cause any plot holes, they screw up our narrative perception of the timeline. While Root Asgardi may not know what Aes Sedhra is, we as the audience have already had this explanation from John Parry 3 episodes ago. So to us, it's blindingly obvious where the knife is. So now we know that anything and everything to do with Root Asgardi going and finding Aes Sedhra will be utterly pointless. Compare this to the narrative timeline in the book, where Root Asgardi hears the name Aes Sedhra in chapter 13, but no one knows what this title means, even though we can kind of guess from all the foreshadowing. Then skip forward 2 chapters to when we get the full explanation from Lord Boreal, when he's telling it to Marisa Coulter, and so we can figure out the knife has been under our noses the whole time. So now, the narrative in the TV show is the equivalent to completing a jigsaw puzzle, then deliberately taking out a few pieces, and expecting us to be surprised when we put them back in and reveal the finished picture. As we already know the definition and the location of the knife, the mystery of the series is all but gone. What's worse is that Root Asgardi's original purpose, to go and unite all the witch clans and bring them to Lord Asriel, is completely sideswept by her new, fruitless search for Aes Sedhra.
Find Asriel this Aes Sedhra. Make his fight yours.
So anything to do with her story will likely make no difference and just be pointless. Continuing with my previous point about season 2, in a lot of the scenes where they reiterate the same information over and over again, it's not only the mystery that's lost, but the narrative impact of this information is drastically weakened in the moments when we're meant to feel something. The best example I can think of, and undoubtedly my most hated moment from the series, would be the scene where Mrs. Coulter finds out that Lyra is Eve. They've spent nearly 2 whole seasons building up to this. There's been all the foreshadowing of the prophecy in the first season, then the witch's interrogation in the first episode, which ended just before Mrs. Coulter got the information she needs. At this point in time, Marisa Coulter is poised on a knife blade and will stop at nothing to know what her daughter is. However, to put it bluntly, the series blows its load by giving us the information too early in the scene with the Magisterium, where Father MacPhail learns from Frau Pavel the new information he's gleaned from the alethiometer about the child and the prophecy.
The name is her destiny. It foretells she will be in the position of the one who brought about our downfall. Mother of us all, cause of all sin.
What makes it worse is that they spin so many circles around this information and try and make it mysterious, when we absolutely, positively know that Lyra is Eve from the dialogue.
What is the child's name?
The alethiometer does not forecast. If it comes about that she is tempted by the serpent, then it is likely she will fall, then dust and sin will triumph.
The name, Frau Pavel. Speak the name.
I've said it before and I'll say it again, even someone with the barest inkling of theological knowledge could know that Lyra is Eve from the dialogue we've been given. But they talk about it like it's the biggest mystery of all time that should be built up and built up, when we already know what they're going to say. This means that when we, the audience, learn this information, we're hearing it from characters who basically have no emotional connection to Lyra. They're all complete strangers at this point. So when Mrs. Coulter learns about this information, a character who has an intensely conflicted emotional connection to her daughter, who has saved her and mistreated her so many times, while it's important from a character standpoint that she knows this information, the impact of the reveal is all but gone, as we already know what Lena Felt is going to say. The series makes it out to be a game-changing moment.
Eve. Eve. The mother of all.
But it's just another thing that happens, and it decreases the drama of the reveal. Now, I should say, the first season wasn't always pitch perfect with this kind of storytelling. In some cases, plot points were made so glaringly obvious that we could figure out the big reveals before they actually happened in the story. A good example of this would be the scene when Lord Asriel sees that Roger is with Lyra and makes it perfectly clear that he intends to use him as a sacrifice. Or the moment where Lyra is searching for clues in Mrs. Coulter's office and basically tells us what indecision is. But the big difference with season 2 is that they take these moments and instead of making them about the emotion, they make them about the explanation. Let's compare some expositional moments from season 1 and season 2, such as Lyra in Mrs. Coulter's office. In this season 1 scene, it's all about the emotion and the atmosphere. Even though Lyra makes it perfectly obvious to us what the Oblation Board is doing, the scene revolves around the heist moment, the tension of her escape, the fear of Mrs. Coulter's demon. We end the scene on the edge of our seats, scarcely daring to breathe as Lyra just makes it back to her bedroom in the nick of time. Or take the reveal that Lord Asriel is Lyra's father. It may happen 2 episodes ahead of time, but the series makes sure it comes from a character who has an emotional connection to Lyra, and then saves the big reveal for another really conflicted emotional moment, when Lyra doesn't know who to trust and is greeted with the worst possible news.
She's your mother, Lyra!
That's what no one is telling you!
Compared to the book, where Lyra just hears about her parentage in a conversation with John Farr, I'd say the series does a better job with this reveal than the novel does. Whereas, in this season 2 scene, the focus is on Mrs. Coulter receiving this information and explaining it to the audience.
She's Eve. Eve before. This time she must not fall. I'll see to that.
She has to state, out loud, that Lyra is Eve and she must not fall, when there is absolutely no precedent for her to do any of this. And I'll admit, she does say this out loud in the book, but what makes this worse is that the Mrs. Coulter in the books is a very different character to the Mrs. Coulter in the TV show. The show has already established that Mrs. Coulter is an extremely non-verbal character. So this break with her portrayal is extremely jarring. Consider what we've already seen in this version of Mrs. Coulter. She's not the sort of person to talk out loud, or talk with her demon, because they don't have the same loving bond that other people do. She's so closed off from her monkey demon that she almost considers herself a separate individual. And we've seen already that the monkey is a source of great resentment for her, so she's unlikely to state her thoughts out loud or to anyone. However, the great thing about Mrs. Coulter's characterization is that she always seems defined by her monkey. Her emotions are so often betrayed by her facial expression and movements. Like the balcony scene from season 1, episode 3, we get so much from Mrs. Coulter in this moment. Her recklessness, her need for freedom, her self-destructive tendencies, her animalized undertones. But instead, in this scene we get...
She's Eve. Eve before.
Considering everything we already know or we've learned about this version of Mrs. Coulter, this vocal explanation is the complete antithesis to her character and is clearly only there for the audience's benefit. She's stating it out loud like any other character, not like Marisa Coulter. Now, let's take a look at one of the ways in which the series really fails when compared to season 1. A lot of the really emotional moments that were so effective in the book or the previous series are just spoiled by weak or pandering dialogue. Let's take a look at my favourite example, the moment where Will is describing what those kids did to his mother. This is a character-defining scene for Will, where we learn the full emotional trauma of his past and feel the hatred and fear he always carries with him from this moment. But it also shows that he respects Lyra enough to hold nothing back in his story, showing that he really trusts her at this point. In the book we have...
They were tormenting her just like those kids at the tower with the cat. They thought she was mad and they wanted to hurt her, maybe kill her. I wouldn't be surprised.
And in the show we have...
These boys found out. They were mean. For no reason.
Do I even need to say anything? They were mean. Okay, I'll stop complaining. I really want to give you an in-detail example of how character moments are truly squandered in season 2 by the bad dialogue. I want to compare the big emotional reunion from episode 7 with an emotional scene from season 1, episode 8. And just show you how different the two are. Let's take a look at season 1, a scene between Lyra and Lord Asriel.
That's what my mother thinks she's doing. Cutting away our demons. Preserving our sinless souls.
I'm not exaggerating when I say that this moment is one of my favourites in the whole series. There is just so much emotion in this moment, and it's all from just a couple of lines. Even though Lyra and Lord Asriel are stating information that we already know, such as what the indecision process is, there is so much being shared between them. Lyra is relaying to her father that she understands what Mrs. Coulter and the Oblation Board are doing, and underneath, relaying that she understands the horror and the cruelty of the world.
You should have seen them. Those who had their demons cut away. They looked empty.
Whereas Lord Asriel is fully confronting the pain that Lyra faced.
Did they try to cut you, Lyra?
And coming to terms with the fact that while he's been holed up in his prison fulfilling his own ambitions, he was completely oblivious to how much danger she was in. Then, when Lyra states how her mother stopped them at Bolvanger, Asriel is suddenly blindsided by the fact that he and Mrs. Coulter are so similar, unwilling to harm their own child, but perfectly willing to damage others, which is exactly what he's going to do to Roger.
Your mother stopped them.
She didn't want to damage me. Happy to damage others.
And despite all the agony he hears from her side of the story, when we look back on this moment, we realise that he is still willing to choose the path that will cause her so much heartbreak.
The thought of Pam being cut from me.
I know.
So you see, there is so much emotion in these words. The characters are explaining to each other what we already know, but they're conveying the underlying pain of their words without actually saying it. Whereas, compared to the scene in season 2. Consider what this scene is meant to be. This is the reunion that we've been waiting a whole series for. This should be the emotional powerhouse of the episode, and yet it just feels underdeveloped. I get it, it's a different scenario. While Lyra and Asriel have a complicated but tangible relationship, these two people are strangers. However, this scene has the potential for so much emotional baggage. There should be laughing, crying, swearing, running into each other's arms, backing away in fear, but instead, it's just a series of blandly spoken statements. And while Andrew Scott and Ami Wilson are giving pretty good performances, it all comes back to the dialogue for me, which is just so clumsy and stilted that it ruins the scene. Let's jump back to the first example. Lord Asriel gives us a big exposition dump about dust, but the key thing is, it's all new information. New, fascinating information that we, the audience, haven't heard before. However, in this scene, most of the words spoken between them have already been said one way or another. In the scene with Lee, in the conversations with Lyra, I'm fine with the characters repeating themselves, but wouldn't it be nice if it actually added something new to the plot? However, unlike the first example, where the two characters are bouncing off each other with their own interpretations, the dialogue in this scene is reduced to bland statements. It's clear once again that they're only pointing things out for the audience's benefit. This really stands out to me when John Parry says,
"My son is the knife bearer."
And while if we're being generous, we could say that this line is meant to convey his disbelief, it just sounds so clunky to me. No one talks like that naturally. Will coming back with,
"You have a demon."
It's a vague statement of fact, not an emotional realization. What's worse about this scene is that it's over too quickly. We cut away from them so rapidly, and we don't get to see the conversation continue with these two. By the time we cut back, we don't know how far their relationship has moved. And seeing as they are strangers at this point, this is the vital information that we want to see. The conversation between Lyra and Lord Asriel had a clear beginning, middle, and end. But with this scene, cutting away after they just met feels so disjointed. A big problem for me is that there is no emotional catharsis with this moment. We don't see them embrace. We don't know if they've recognized their bond as father and son, even if they haven't seen each other for years. So when we catch up with them in the next scene, we're left scrambling to figure out what point they're at, and this just makes it feel like they have no connection at all. I feel like the scene could have been vastly improved if they'd modified the dialogue to make it sound more natural. Will saying, Is That Your Demon still carries over the fact that he knows what a demon is, yet it makes him sound so much more uncertain, and considering he's meant to be wary around his father, I think this really adds to what his character is supposed to be feeling. On John Parry's part, I think they should have made his realization that Will is the knife bearer so much more negative. Because he's just seen his son, and now he knows that his only child is bound up in this dangerous destiny. Maybe it should be something like, Will, you... the knife? How could this have happened? You're just a child. The fact that we don't see John Parry ask about how his son got the knife makes it sound like he doesn't care, like he isn't asking the important questions. And considering how much he's stressed to Lee that he desperately wants to find his son, not actually acknowledging the responsibility he feels as a parent, and then the complicated nature of realizing that the unknown warrior he was going to send on a journey to Lord Asriel is his own son, makes all of his encouragements and his words of praise to Will just feel empty. And for me, all of this stems back to that one phrase, my son is the knife bearer, when it should have been so much more. And it's just a really bad line anyway. I'll admit, the dialogue does get a little better in the subsequent scenes. Even if it is just the two of them reciting what we already know, at least we have some conflict and some emotion between them. But the stilted nature of their first meeting and the jarring, unnatural dialogue just sours their whole reunion and gives this moment such a sterile atmosphere, which should not have happened in the big emotional powerhouse reunion. Now, you all know that I love to harp on about the ways in which the TV series changes from the book. I have to make it clear, I'm not condemning every single new scene in season 2, because in all honesty, these moments may be the best of the entire series. Practically everything added to Mrs. Coulter's character is absolutely incredible. We learn so much more about her by exploring her relationship with her monkey, her experience as a woman in Lyra's world, and the trauma of her childhood. The conversation with Lee Scoresby is absolutely one of my favourite added moments in the entire season. It doesn't rewrite or retcon the character. It just adds so many new and interesting dimensions to them.
I will rip out every nail. And I will break every bone.
And it won't break me, and you know it won't. Because it wouldn't break you either.
So, with this in mind, I'd like to argue that the additional scenes in season 2 that don't work are the ones that have no narrative standing in the book, don't make sense, or just take away from the original plot. In season 1, a lot of the added scenes, while not exactly necessary, are really good at fleshing out the world because they're directly adapted from the book. A lot of them are scenes that were described in passing or flashbacks, but ones we never took part in as principal characters. Mrs. Coulter meeting with Yoffa Ragnarsson is described in a flashback, and the Egyptian infiltration scene is adapted directly from an ambush in the book with different characters. However, in season 2, the focus seems to have shifted into adapting scenes that we know must have happened in the book because the story wouldn't make sense otherwise, but are not directly essential to the plot. This makes the whole series feel really meandering and roundabout. If we're learning nothing new in these supposedly new moments, then the story just grinds to a halt. As I've ironically said many times throughout this video, a lot of the scenes are just different characters learning the same information over and over again to make sure that we know that they know this information. And the scenes they added in that don't revolve around the main characters? Oh boy! One of the best, or, well, worst examples, is the scene with Will's grandparents. If we look at this scene from a narrative standpoint, Will finding out that he has living relatives that he's never even heard of before should be massively important to the plot. But when we meet them, they're just there 1 minute, gone the next, with nothing added. Truly, they add nothing to the plot that we don't know already. And so this whole sequence is just a massive waste of time. The only contribution that this scene makes is that Will has his heart broken when another adult betrays him. But when considering the series has already made it a point that this is all he expects from authority figures, then it just seems pointless to heave this boring betrayal onto us if it's not going to amount to anything. If the grandparents were in season one, maybe they could have added to the plot. Maybe they could have been the ones leading the manhunt for Will when they realize that he and Elaine have gone missing. Maybe they could have been the ones that alerted the papers, and it's through their information that Boreal manages to blackmail Will when he needs him to find the knife. But if these supposedly pivotal characters just appear for a few moments of dead space and do not affect Will's character in any way, do not affect the story in any way, and then just disappear without any contributions, then why were they necessary? And now, just because I want to complain about it some more, the pièce de résistance, the crème de la crème, the most pointless inclusion to series 2 that I can possibly think of. Serafina has been making a big deal about how Will's hand is badly injured and they cannot heal it with herbs in Jitagatse, so they'll need to travel back to Lyra's world. This causes a clash within the group, as Lyra wants to stay with Will and help him search for his father. They spend a good long while arguing about it, and then one mystical healing scene later, and Will's hand is completely cured. I'm not even joking, they spend so much time on it, and later on in the episode, they have a scene where Serafina unwraps Will's hand and they remark the spell worked.
It's holding up. The spell worked.
A wound caused by magic must be closed by magic.
So this completely negates a good chunk of the dialogue and makes their quest back to Lyra's world utterly pointless if they could have just healed him then and there. Also, this means if the spell worked, they leave out the blood moss scene, and considering Will's uncertainty and mistrust in seeing his father, then wouldn't it make so much more sense to include the blood moss scene? John Parry healing his wounded son, make that the inciting incident to have Will finally put his trust in his father? Nope! Instead, we just get one big pile of nothing. So, Jack Thorne, what happened? You were doing so well in the previous season. How did we get to this? Well, I have my theories. In season one, the predominant writer was Jack Thorne. He is the credited scriptwriter for all 8 of the episodes. Whereas in season 2, 5 out of the 7 episodes are co-credited to Jack Thorne, or he's not even the official series writer. Now, I've noticed this sort of thing happen before with a show that I really love. Doctor Who, perhaps you've heard of it. I noticed in season 8, for me, the quality of the show had just gone really downhill, with the tone being all over the place, the characters were not fully realised, the stories felt disjointed, and the plots were pretty weak. Well, if you look at the series credits, Stephen Moffat was co-writing with a whole lot of other people. I'm not directly correlating these two events, but I do argue that when multiple people's visions are being used to create a show, this can be a bit of a problem, as people are going to have different ideas instead of one solid vision for how the story should go. The reason why series 2 might have felt so roundabout and repetitive is that in nearly every episode, we had a different set of writers who felt like they needed to establish the world all over again, and each one according to a different perception, and COVID can't have helped either. Now, I am making sweeping generalizations and conspiracy theories, because this is not the true story of season 2. As much as I absolutely hate some of the choices and dislike the writing overall, I still had a really good time watching season 2. I remember having a great time in episodes 4 and 5, and even if the ending ultimately left me cold, I was crying my eyes out for parts of episode 7, especially Lee Scoresby's death. There were lots of creative ideas that I really loved with the season, and I just wish they could have followed through on some of them and left some of the worst ones out. The problem for me was that season 1 was just so incredible that season 2 could never really measure up to it, and then when I noticed a bit of a downgrade in the writing, then this just widened the gap for me. But you have the right to say it. I'm being whiny. I'm being harsh, I'm being negative, I'm being overly critical. I'm tearing apart a show that I've built my reputation on absolutely loving with all of my heart. I want to rectify my negativity and give you guys an idea of how much His Dark Materials means to me, as a fan, as a writer, as a critic, as a lover of stories. So for my next video, I'm going to be making a His Dark Materials tag. You can ask a question in the comments below, or you can send me a question on Instagram, or you can write it in my story, and I'll answer it for you in the next video. You can ask me absolutely anything. about the books, the film, the TV show, the prequel and sequel novels. Not Serpentine though, I haven't read that one. I just really want to let you know how much I love the show, and I want you to get a feel for my enthusiasm for it. And I want to give you a feel for my enthusiasm for it, and let you know, for better or worse, season one or season two, doesn't matter, how much I love His Dark Materials. So thank you all so much for watching. Please subscribe to my channel down below if you want to see more from me. And I'll see you all soon. Bye!